113, initiating broadcast of Fascinating Nouns in 3, 2, 1.
Hello everyone, and welcome to Fascinating Nouns. Now if you are listening to this transmission, we are still the galaxy's most trusted source for incredible people, places, things, and ideas. Now together we arrive at this curious nexus point, and we will explore the strange, unusual, offbeat, bizarre, intriguing, interesting, invigorating, quirky, quaint, quizzical, weird, wild, wacky, the fun, the frivolous, and the fringe, plus all the spaces in between. I am your host, Daniel J. Glenn.
You know, I bet a lot of people listening to this episode, when you say who's at the top of the evolutionary charts, you probably think us. Probably human beings are the first thing that come to mind. And there's a strong argument for that. We have gigantic brains, and it has allowed us to overcome almost everything that nature has thrown at us. It has allowed us to be, you know, an invasive species across the entire planet. And as a matter of fact, we are changing the very nature of the planet by our existence, and the fact that we are everywhere and there's bazillions of us. That's a technical number. And, you know, I think that's not exactly true. You know, I mean, everything I just said is 100% true, but we're not at the top evolutionarily speaking. We have lots of design flaws, as a matter of fact. The human body is riddled with design flaws, and that is the topic of today's episode, the design flaws of the human body. We're going to talk to Dr. Nathan Lents, who wrote an incredible book called Human Errors. You know, when the things that are at the top from an evolutionary standpoint, sharks, cockroaches, things that have remained unchanged for millions of years, we've really only remained, you know, we've gone through tons of changes, and we've only been around for a couple hundred thousand years, maybe. We're relatively new, and there's been lots of changes. Cockroaches have essentially the same since dinosaurs roamed the earth, which is that's when you know you've made it, when you've been around that long. So here we're going to get into these design flaws. We got lots of them, and they are just fascinating. Most of them don't affect your day-to-day life, obviously, but some do, and some may once you find out about them. So I just want to get right into this. So Dr. Nathan Lents, thank you so much for being on the show today. Now, I got to tell you, this book is absolutely amazing. It kind of changed my life, that's not really hyperbole, because, you know, I've always thought of myself as basically flawless. You know, I'm physically gifted. I'm incredibly intelligent. You know, I see myself as a sterling reproductive partner. But your book kind of changed all that. You know, and I'm not sure about any of those statements. And I really don't know whether to thank you for exposing my fault so I can better prepare myself, or I should be disturbed at the fact that I'm extraordinarily frail and extremely fallible. I don't know where I fall on that line, Dr. Lents. I'm perfectly honest
with you. Well, let me tell you, I do think it's a little comforting to know that none of us is perfect. But I don't know that I'd use the word frail. I do think the thing to remember about anyone, especially if you have a high opinion of any performance measure, mm-hmm. That you might be very well adapted for certain tasks in a certain environment. But that's all subject to change. It's all subject to luck. So if we put you with your skill set and whatever your natural proclivities are into all kinds of different environments that exist in the world today, and especially if we go backwards in time, you might not have been quite so special. So that's always a humbling thought.
How dare you?
I think it's always a humbling thought that whatever we're good at is largely a function of luck, and that we happen to be in an environment where that can actually take fruit.
Okay. So I'm going to go with the extraordinarily disturbed with you for pointing these things out. I'm going to go with that one.
Fair enough.
I mean, it was pretty amazing to think, because, you know, especially with the way – I mean, human beings definitely have a high opinion of themselves.
No doubt about it. Pinnacles of creation. And
right. So it is kind of interesting to see all the different things that are really kind of wrong with us. Now, what made you specifically want to get into dissecting, you know, kind of the goof ups, the evolutionary goofs in the human body?
Well, you know, what's interesting is that I assumed a book like this had already been written. Because there are books out there about sort of quirky, weird design out in nature. Mm-hmm. So not in any way focusing on humans, but just from all kinds of things. In fact, Actually, one of Richard Dawkins' books called The Blind Watchmaker has a few examples of weird design in other animals. So that was one thing. And then also some of the individual chapters of my book have been written as their own entire book. Like there, you can get books on cognitive bias, for example, and some of those do cover the evolutionary part of it. You can also find books about the genome. And in fact, actually, Junk in the Genome, that's the name of my chapter. There's a book called Junk DNA that I actually reviewed a few years ago that came out from Columbia University Press. So a lot of this has been gathered in various ways, but nobody had sort of taken a global look at humanity, at human beings, and focused that lens on evolutionary mismatch and poor design and vestigial structures. And no one had ever sort of cataloged all throughout the human body and mind. So it was one of those moments that a writer always hopes they'll have, and that is that you think of something that hasn't been written yet before. Right. So I got really lucky that nobody thought to write that yet.
And that kind of falls into what you said earlier, whereas maybe your skill set wouldn't have been great, 100 years ago, but you happen to fall into the right point in time where you could write this book and basically change people's thinking of themselves. And I love Junk in the Genome. That's first of all, that's a great chapter, just a great chapter title, content notwithstanding, great title. And vestigial structures, I love those. And we're going to get into some of those because there's two things that you don't talk about in the book, and we'll get to, the book in a second. I want to talk about you for a – can we focus on you for a second? Do you mind if we –
This is my favorite topic.
Okay. Wonderful. And you're probably an expert on it, I imagine, which makes this perfect timing.
I try.
So you've actually are into a lot of really interesting things, including the human being's microbiome. Specifically the necrobiome. I'd never heard that word before, but that's essentially the microbiome after the body dies. And you kind of do studies to determine, time of death and how it relates to crime scene investigation, as well as the genetic differences amongst houseplants and trace residue as it relates to crime scenes. Both of those are extraordinarily different, although kind of tied. Tell me a little bit about those. Those are fascinating.
Well, if you look at the published research that I've done, put my books aside for a second and just think about the peer-reviewed articles. I publish two or three articles a year, in a good year. A brief look would make it seem like I'm all over the place, that I have no sort of steady research program, that I'm always just jumping from area to area. And in one sense, that's correct. But actually, there are common threads through all of my work, and there's two of them. First of all, I work in a forensic science program, so I'm always doing forensic science research, mostly because the students in the program, that's what they need to do to, write their thesis and that kind of thing. So I end up as a mentor on some of these forensic science projects, and then we design the projects together and do them. So that's why there's a forensic bend to about half of my research. But the other thing that's in common with all of them, that you have to dig a little deeper to see it, is that it all has to do with genetics and specifically DNA sequences. So my work beginning in the 90s when I was working on soybeans and nematodes, all the way through now, I've always really enjoyed working with DNA sequences, meaning these elements in our genome and what their function is, how they function and how they derive their function from the sequence. So if you look at the microbiome work that I did, the postmortem microbiome work that I did, and that is ongoing. How we identify all of those species is by their DNA sequences, by little signatures or barcodes, however you want to think about it, in their DNA, that allows us to identify them and classify them. And what I love about that approach is that you don't have to know anything about the bacteria ahead of time. It is a totally unbiased approach. You don't know what you're going to find, and you don't bias yourself by any kind of identification technique. Instead, you sequence the DNA. Now, it may be possible, and in fact, it happens every time we do an experiment, that some of the bacteria that we sequence, whose DNA we sequence, they have never been explored before. They've never been identified or characterized. But it's still not a dead end for us because we have that DNA sequence. We know what kind of bacteria it is. So we might not know the species, but we'll know the order or the class or the phylum, which category it falls into in the taxonomic classification. And that's useful information. So all of my work is basically me going blind reading A's and C's and G's and T's, and then trying to make sense of those and what they do. And so, and by the way, most of those projects have now either been published or are moving on. I'm really focusing on the human genome of late. So it's a big genome, bigger than most of the genomes I've been working with. And I'm going to be reading those A's and C's and G's and looking for cool, interesting things that haven't been found yet.
So when you discover new bacteria species, do you get to name them? I mean, it's actually blows my mind you're actually to be able to find brand new species.
Yeah, well, you could if you were to go in and characterize them. The way this works is there are so many bacteria that have yet to be characterized that pretty much any time you do an experiment like this, there will be tons of them. But just because you find them doesn't mean you get to name them, because what I do is I take a swab and I break open all the bacteria and then I isolate the DNA. So once I've done that, there's no way to go backwards. So all I have is the DNA. If I wanted to actually name that bacterial species, I'd have to isolate it, like intact living, microbe, grow it up, and then do all kinds of work to characterize it and see what its properties are. The way I do my experiments, it's too late. I break open all the cells and release their DNA, so the story's over. So I could publish the sequences, and of course we do that because every time you do these kind of work, you have to make your data sets available. So the sequences are out there, but they're just sort of unclassified, and I don't get the prerogative of naming the bacteria unless I go do the work to isolate it and characterize it.
Oh man! I mean, don't you want like a lentizoma running around out there?
I suppose that could be an interesting thing to do, but I haven't gone that way yet.
Oh man! If you like talking about yourself, you got to name something after yourself. This is the perfect place to do it. I want to get into this because I'd love to have a bacteria named after me. So I may clean up your work. You let you do the hard stuff, and I'll just isolate it and
It's not really that hard to do. If you really wanted to get in there and characterize some of these uncharacterized bacteria, there's a roadmap of how to do that.
I want to characterize them for sure.
Yeah, it's really not that difficult. You just need a lot of lab equipment. That's what's the daunting thing for a lot of people is you have to purchase all this, you know, scientific equipment, which doesn't come cheap. But
So not only one other thing, because you were quoted in this really cool paper about the microbiome in someone's mouth, which I find interesting. I was going to ask you, where do you get the bodies to do all of these necrobiome tests? But I assume they're their crime scene. Are you a resurrectionist? How does that kind of work?
No. So there are four. Actually, I believe there's five now decomposition research facilities in the United States. I only have an affiliation with one of them, and that is the one – it's called the Anthropological Research Facility at the University of Tennessee in Knoxville. And the way this works is for a long time, all of the bodies were actually donated by the coroner. So what happens is if in the state – or in the county of Knoxville – in the state of Tennessee, if a body, comes into the possession of the coroner and nobody claims it for 30 days, it becomes in the custody of the coroner, and it's his body to do whatever he wants with. And so, in Knoxville, the coroner would donate these unclaimed bodies to the research facility, and then they would go out there and be placed and be studied. Nowadays, more than half, and that still happens, but nowadays more than half of the bodies there. That doesn't happen at all anymore. They've been able to completely replace that. But now what they do is there's two kinds of bodies that come there. One are a body dies and the family either can't or won't pay for the funeral and disposal and burial, so they'll actually donate it. So the family donates it right after death to the research facility because it's basically the cheapest thing you can do. It doesn't cost any money whatsoever. If it's within 100 miles, the facility will go and pick up the body and the family can be done with it. And about half of the bodies come this way, the bodies are pre-registered. So there are people who sign up to have their body go to this facility when they die. And this facility has been going on since the 1970s, so it's pretty famous in the area, and there are a lot of volunteers that have happily signed up to have their body go to this kind of research. And if you think about it, it's kind of your final gift. It's the one thing that we can't get any other way. And your final act to be this gigantic act of generosity. I think it's a wonderful thing that the donors do.
So there's no. It's all you use the word donor. So there's no money involved in the priest signing up.
No, there's no money. No money changes hands for any of this, and that's why.
Well, the research division makes. I mean, they make money. So they make tons of money on donations and.
Right? No, they don't make any money. They have to write grants to get the money to do their work, but nobody makes any money. I mean, they have a salary, but again, that comes either from the university or from the grants that they write.
Okay.
Right. Yeah. And there is a permanent staff, but actually, believe it or not, most of the staff of the facility, the regular staff that documents each day's decay, you know, the state of each body every day, five days a week, those are students.
Oh,
those
wow.
are students. So they're completing it for academic credits. And yeah, it's not as expensive an operation as you would think. I mean, it does cost money, but most of the research is actually funded. My project that I did down there was funded. And, you know, it just paid me enough to get the samples and then do the work. It's not a pleasant place to be in, obviously. It's it's very busy. They place anywhere between one and three bodies every week. And so it gets crowded. It's not a huge facility. It's about the size of a, you know, small parking lot. And it's hilly and it's wooded. So, you can't walk far without seeing a body in some state of decomposition.
That's insane. I mean, it sounds like a zombie film. You know, it's like exactly what you see when you're watching the movies. I mean, I imagine most of the money goes to nose plugs and sort of that stuff that balm you wipe underneath your... No?
No, you don't do any of that. Don't do any of that. Because that would only sort of cover it up temporarily, and then you'd get a big whiff. And the best thing to do is you just acclimate. So you just go in and you get used to it. And because your body desensitizes on sensations, right? So you smell it really strong when you first walk in, if it's summertime. And then... Right. Over time, it sort of, you know, gets less and less, and you just get used to it. But I mean, you do want to wash your clothes because it can, like any smell, it can stick to the clothes a little bit. So you, right. Most of us change our clothes, but we actually suit up a little bit. You know, we're not obviously protecting the bodies, but what we're doing is trying to not contaminate them with different kinds of bacteria and things like that might change their state of decomposition. So,
Wow.
Yeah, it is fascinating work, but it's difficult work. I mean, it's hard not to have an emotional reaction when you're working with, you know, a dead person. Because this is somebody who was, you know, walking around a few days before. So it's hard not to let it upset you a little bit.
Yeah, I imagine it's a very very strange sensation. Very, I mean, it's the whole idea of that facility is it's not something that a normal person would. Mentally be able to handle, you know. I think that
it's not
very
for the
strange.
Faint of heart.
No,
not for the faint of heart. Do you know the story of how it got started? The first one.
I feel like I do, but remind me.
So there was a anthropologist, forensic anthropologist named Bill Bass. He's still alive, and he was the only state certified forensic anthropologist in the state of Tennessee at that time, and this was in the 1970s. And he was called by some sheriff, I guess in Knoxville. I'm not sure. And they said, we found some remains and we'd like you to tell us how old they are. And so he came out and they were treating it as a crime scene. It was a shallow grave, that kind of thing. It was mostly just bones. But he said, you know, this is beyond a few months, but it's definitely not more than, you know, a year or two because it's relatively intact. So I can't say for sure, but it's more than 3 or 4 months, but less than a year, let's say. Mm. Well, it turns out they were actually able to identify the body and it was a Civil War veteran. So he was off by about 110 years.
Yeah.
And that was when Dr. Bass realized, holy cow, we have no idea what we're doing when it comes to decomposition and estimating states of decomposition when we have unknown remains. So he said, well, what we need to do is have a research facility to study this scientifically. So that's what he did. He contracted with the coroner. He got permission from the University of Tennessee, and it's been in that same location ever since. And it operates just right outside the back side of the parking lot of the hospital, that the University of Tennessee Hospital. It's not very auspicious. You would drive right past it and not know anything. The local employees, of course, know where it is. And in the summertime, it makes its presence known.
Right.
But they've been humming along now for 40 years.
It's amazing that, you know, a medical professional. I mean, the history of medicine is littered with people who do the wrong thing. And never admit to it. And it's nice that a guy, you know, admits to it and then changes it and kind of creates a facility to study it.
Yeah,
I like that part of the story. But now, so let's get into this book. We went in a nice little rabbit hole here, and I love that because that's a really fascinating aspect of what you do. Well, and what you know, the book is about something completely different on the surface, let's say, but equally as fascinating. It's about human. It's called Human Errors, and it's about all the kind of goof ups in the human body that we don't really think about. I want to start by talking about two that are do not show up in the book. One you mentioned in another paper, and then one I came up with. I want you to tell me about it. But the one you brought up I thought was really interesting, and that is, I think you were quoted saying, this is the most useless part of the human body, and it's the pyramidalis muscle, which is used to flex.
Pyramidalis muscle, yeah.
Which is used to flex a non-existent tail that we used to have. So this still exists? Does it, like, attach to our coccyx?
Yeah, it does. Not to the coccyx, but it does attach to mostly just soft tissue on one end. And this is the thing, is it's also slightly different from person to person. So when and anatomists have known about this muscle for years and have been writing about it. And this was the kind of thing that came no surprise to that community, but a lot of people outside of that community didn't realize this. But yeah, it does attach to the stump of the coccyx on one side and really just a smooth muscle on the other. And some people have it, some people don't. And you can squish around a little bit in that area. There are lots of slang words for that area, but basically between the anus and either the testicles or the
Vagina. The taint or the chode. Yeah.
That's what I'm talking about. Right. So you can sometimes squish that around and the muscle can do that, but it doesn't have anything to do with continence or bowel control or anything like that. It has literally no function whatsoever. It doesn't do anything. And if you remove it, you don't have any loss of any of that. And in fact, the whole tailbone itself is vestigial in the sense that it is true that it bears some of the weight as we sit. But if you lose your tailbone, and you can get cancer, and it's a bone like any other, and you can get bone cancer in your coccyx, they will remove it. And individuals who have a coccygectomy have no trouble sitting down. So it really doesn't do anything for you. In fact, actually, we shouldn't be spending time sitting very long anyway. But that's another. But yeah, the coccyx and the pyramidalis muscle are both truly vestigial in the sense that there's no real current function to them. They're not the only ones, but yeah.
So is there, what is, so now that we're on this, what is the medical term for the taint, for the area between your,
The perineum.
Yeah, the perineum.
It's called the perineum, or sometimes pronounced perineum.
Okay, so there is a real technical term for this.
Yeah, perineum. Yeah.
So that's not what, scientists and doctors aren't running around calling it, various.
They would call it the perineum. And the time, it's not clinically important very often, except.
Right.
except that's where they sometimes slice women during childbirth when they perform an episiotomy.
Oh, yeah.
That's where they slice. And the problem is that episiotomies are almost never medically indicated. So they finally have stopped doing it. But, in the old days, in the 60s and 70s, they always, let's just give her a little help and give her an open wound middle of her crotch.
Yeah.
It's really not a good idea because, in fact, I know someone who pushed twins through, and the first twin was much bigger than the second twin, and the doctors had to change in between twins because of an emergency, and the second doctor performed an episiotomy during the second delivery.
Oh my God.
It was like the first one was fine, and now we're doing this.
Yeah.
But that's called the perineum, and it's totally unnecessary. But what's interesting about the perineum is that it shows the homology between the male and female body, because while it's shorter in females, you can see it was like a midline in the undercarriage before there were any genitals whatsoever. It was this midline between the anus and then what was going to become coming later. Right. And then the folds grew into either the labia or the scrotum, but the perineum is just sort of right there. So that's another sort of leftover from evolution, is this, if you look under at an embryo, you see it's like looking into the past. From simpler states of our body.
Yeah, I mean, that's what I love about this is, like, the entire book is really built on the building blocks of evolution and this whole idea that, our form, like, we can't evolve anything beyond, we use existing forms to kind of create new biological devices, so to speak. You know, like if you're making wings, your arms become the wings, or, you know, it's like these small little subtle changes to the current system. And so no overhaul can ever really happen because you have these existing structures that kind of have to be used. Extraordinarily fascinating. So let me ask you, so here's mine, which to me, this feels like a design flaw. And I feel like as a man, you're going to agree with me. Why are the testicles located outside of the body? Why are they not covered in bone? Why are they so sensitive? You know, I understand sperm has to be kept at a lower temperature. I get that. But why couldn't we evolve it in some way where that was not the case? And this is true amongst, you know, most mammals, I believe, right?
Yes, most mammals. So this is a perfect example, and you stated it very, very well.
Well, thank
There's
you.
There's no reason that the testicles have to be outside of the body cavity, of the main abdominal cavity. It is true that sperm develop better a couple degrees lower, but that's because they're outside the body. You know, it's important not to interpret that the wrong way. It's not like they escaped the abdomen because they needed the cold space and that's where they went and found it. They've adapted to the slightly colder environment and that's where it's optimal. It's not like optimal temperature for sperm development is like some constant in the universe, like the speed of light or it will develop at whatever it's adapted to develop at. And in fact, if you look at all of the cetaceans, so these are the dolphins and whales, they have internal testicles and they do just fine. They have no trouble making sperm. So what happened was in the earliest mammals, this is my thinking. And remember also, ovaries do fine just inside, and they're right. also making gametes. So
right, I was going to say eggs are inside. Yeah, it's all the same. Yeah. thing. Women, they got to
yeah,
figure
I
it
mean,
out.
Yeah, I mean, the sperm are a little different than eggs in the sense that you have storage and all that, but it's still it doesn't make any sense. It's not biochemically necessary for it to have been that way. But what I think happened is you had testicles that were in near the abdominal wall, and our ancestors were not warm-blooded the way that we are. And so as the body temperature began to warm, as endothermy evolved in our lineage, it was just the testicles were already right almost on the outside anyway. And so that they didn't have to adapt to the warmer temperature. The easier adaptation was just to migrate out of the inguinal canal and come outside. It's a flip of the coin. It could have gone one way or the other. And in some lineages, it didn't go that. And it was just that was the adaptation that happened to come quicker. Some change was probably necessary, but some change was necessary in every single cell of the body because every single cell of our body is adapted for 37 degrees Celsius, every single cell, except for a few, as we talked about in the testes that prefer 35. So every cell whose ancestors preferred a colder environment had to make those biochemical tweaks to get back up to where they're working right at 37. So with the testes, they just decided to take the simpler route and say, I'm out of here.
Right.
And they migrated out of the inguinal canal. And now, of course, this is a huge vulnerability for males.
Right.
But you have to remember that you're thinking about this only as a male, and I'm a male. And so we're very egocentric species. Right. We're also an egocentric gender.
Right.
But the thing is that actually males are extremely expendable in the animal world. You need one male for every 1,000 females. And, you know, if you want to be literal about it, males are really just good for very little. In terms of species, that really the sperm's all we got. So there just wasn't the kind of intense selective pressure on testes because males just aren't near as important for the species. It hurts our ego to say that, but
yeah, I'm all right with it.
And then, of course, the other vulnerability besides just the fact that it can get hurt and injured and all that is that it creates a weakness, a little bit of perforation in the abdominal cavity. Mm-hmm. And so what's called an inguinal hernia is something like 10 times more common in males than in females because there's a leftover weakness in the abdominal wall from when the testis migrated through. So if you know anybody who's ever had an inguinal hernia, that's not the umbilical one, not the one up in your tummy, but the one down in your crotch.
Yeah.
You can tell him or her that's when it's left over from when his testes migrated out of his abdomen when he was young, when
Which
he
was a
either
coin
in
flip.
Utero.
But that's that's a coin flip. That's what's so amazing to me is every time, you know, now I'm thinking every time I'm going to get, you know, when I'm playing basketball, getting racked in the nards, I don't want to get like think that it could have been a coin flip and I could have been fine. That's ridiculous. But anyway, that's as it goes in the human body. You know, it's funny because that specific example, I specifically remember being in high school and I had a biology teacher. And I remember when this came up, I was thinking the same thing, like, well, why are the testicles outside the body? And his answer was, oh, well, that's because the sperm, you know, develops at a lower temperature. And he was also religious. So he was like, well, you know, God doesn't make mistakes. And I'm like, well, hey, I don't think you're supposed to be telling us that in a science class. But also, like, that just feels like a mom saying, well, because, you know, it's like, well, no, as you just mentioned, they didn't have to develop that way. That one always just struck me as a very, very strange situation. But, you know, there are a million strange situations in this book. But one thing I want to talk to you about, from an intellectual level, because this is something that I feel like I've read this someplace. I'm not the first person to kind of have this idea. But, you know, in the book, you really kind of hit home this idea that evolution is these micro evolutions. So there's no real, you know, there's no huge evolutionary jumps. Everything are these small, little, extraordinarily random events. You know, I don't, this is my logical thinking. I don't have any, you know, letters after my name, but there aren't a lot of random things that happen in science, really. And so when we start looking at, like, this idea that everything, that they're just random mutations, I don't know that I believe that, because what makes sense to me is our DNA and our genome and our biology is such that when certain environmental factors exist, those mutations, quote-unquote, would be significantly the probability that adaptable mutations would occur seems to me like it would be higher. For example, you know, the fish that, you know, the fish that comes out of the water and grows legs, right? Well, obviously it didn't, like, happen overnight, but this slow evolution of coming from the sea to the land, you know, wouldn't it make more sense that as a fish over generations becomes close to the surface, that extraordinary environmental change is actually the driving force for mutation, and they don't just sit close to the edge of the land and the water waiting for a random mutation to occur so that they can pop out?
So I have bad news for you. Good news and bad news. Good news, you're almost right.
Okay, that's fair enough. All right.
You're almost right. The bad news is you just have to change a little bit of the phrasing and you've got it. So what you said was that these extraordinary environmental situations cause the mutation, and that's not correct.
Mutations, well, I said a higher probability to cause a mutation.
But it does. The environment has no effect on the mutation. What it is it selects for that mutation. But in the background, all the time, there are mutations going on in your body, and they're random and they're uncontrolled, and they can be major or minor. And they're just constantly building up what we call this neutral resource of genetic variability. That if it's bad, it kills you. If it's good, it helps you. But 99.9% of the time, it's neutral. And you just build on that variation. Let me give you an example. So the ability to drink milk among Europeans, we'll say, to drink milk after adulthood. So usually after the age of weaning, and that you can tweak this between age, say, 2 and 9, you lose the ability to digest milk, to digest the sugar that's found in milk, lactose. And most adults prior to, say, 6,000 years ago in Europe would have been lactose intolerant, like the rest of the planet. Outside of Europe, most of the rest of the planet is lactose intolerant. Well, at the right place at the right time, a point mutation occurred that actually kept that gene on. And then you had individuals who could continue to drink milk throughout their lives. And what an enormous advantage that was, because the person who first had it, they were already farming. They already had livestock. We actually don't believe it was cows first. It was goats. So goats were being used. And by the way, they were even working with the milk. They were making cheese and yogurt from the milk. But they knew they couldn't drink the milk right out. But if it turned into cheese, they could, because there's not much lactose left in cheese. It all gets metabolized. So in other words, here was the right time where the perfect mutation could come in, and then boom, the advantage, because you got to remember what a huge advantage that was. Milk is highly nutritious, lots of fat and protein. It's also mobile, so you take it with you. You can never run out, and it's the cleanest source of water that you ever would have had. So it just had so many advantages for it. Now, you know, you would say, well, what are the odds of that happening at the right place in the right time? I would say pretty good, because when you're hitting things all around the genome randomly, eventually, you know, you will have the perfect lightning strike. And the way that we know this is it's happened three other times in the human population. So there are a tribe of pastoralists in sub-Saharan Africa, and they also are now able to drink milk, and it's goat's milk, again, that they use. And it's because they've been, you know, as shepherds, living as shepherds for hundreds, if not thousands of years, and the right mutation came along, and it's a totally different mutation than the one that we see in Europeans. And so if it were that the environment created the mutation, then it wouldn't be the same mutation. It's two totally different mutations, but they have the same effect. So what the environment does is it does not cause mutation, it selects mutation. So it picks winners and losers, and it does so fairly quickly on geological timescales.
Hmm. I mean, it is interesting. Now I will say that you know a lot more than I do. I don't know that you've convinced me, because I mean, you know, before Galileo, people thought that, you know, there were scientists who said, well, we revolve around, you know, the Earth, sun revolves around the Earth. Damn it. And they were totally wrong. But they said it with extreme authority. So I'm going to go into the minority here. I'm putting my money down. I think we're going
to
find out.
Here's what I would say to you, though. What I would say to you.
All right.
There's no mechanism for the environment creating a specific mutation. Like, how does the environment reach into your DNA, know which thing to change, and change it? Whereas the randomness of mutation, we have that pretty well worked out. We know about mutation rates. We know where mutation hotspots happen. We know how mutations spread through populations. So the theory of unguided mutations leading to natural selection, there's no gaps in our knowledge there. The randomness makes us all uneasy. Trust me, I get that feeling too. It's not satisfying, but it's a fully coherent theory. Whereas the idea that the environment somehow causes the mutation, you know, I have no clue what mechanism could do that. How does the drinking of milk reach into the DNA, find the right gene, and make the right switch? You know, there's just no even plausible mechanism for that. So I'm not saying you're wrong. I'm just saying there's no way that we know of for it to be right.
Well, I don't know that. I mean, I think that paradigm that it reaches in and changes the DNA, I don't know that that is like necessarily the right mindset that I would have. It would be more of like, you know, as the situation changes, I mean, I understand what you were saying, but I think that there's something other than random. I mean, the quantum mechanics is all based on this idea of random. Most people who study quantum mechanics don't really understand quantum mechanics. It seems entirely random. And I'm pretty sure that in 20 years or whatever, when we figure out the mechanics, it's going to be like, oh, that makes perfect sense. Like, it's not random. The idea of that science is random is, you know, it's not that I need a perfect narrative. I just don't know I think science makes sense. I think that's like its hallmark. And so when you start talking about random things, I don't know that it just seems random. I just don't believe there's any way it can be random. And I could be wrong. I mean, it doesn't happen often,
I can give you more examples. So one of the most famous scientists in molecular evolution, his name is Richard Lenski, and he's been running this experiment for 40 years. It's called the long-term evolution experiment. Anyway, he set up 12 flasks and all in identical conditions. And all 12 flasks of these bacteria had some of their adaptations that occurred in all 12 flasks. So in other words, they started to grow faster, right? Because you get a very competitive environment. But the precise mutations that they took to get there were totally different in all 12. So the environment created the setup, which it was the competition. And of course, the reward of growing faster is leaving more offspring and taking over the flask, blah, blah, blah. But if there was anything that the environment was doing, why is it doing it totally differently in the 12 different flasks? They all ended up with a totally unique set of mutations with the same long-term effect, which is, of course, to grow faster. That wasn't the only change. There's lots of other changes in these. I mean, he's been writing. He's in the National Academy of Science. I mean, he's got tons and tons of articles on this. And he's seen all kinds of crazy random things that happen, but they're only random in the sense that it's like a hole punched into the wall, but it's not random what we see winning. So nature doesn't give the mechanism, but nature picks the winners and losers. So the final result is trimmed by nature. And he's even seen some weird things in one flat that happens in one flask and not others. For example, the ability to digest citrate in an oxygen-rich environment. This is a new ability that one of his flask of bacteria was able to come up with, which of course gave him a huge advantage. But it was such an incredibly unlikely event because it required sort of rearrangement of part of the genome. Such an unlikely event, but it happened. You know, 40 years of these bacteria growing as fast as they can, crazy, crazy, unlikely things do happen every now and then. And this one had an advantage, but none of the 11 flasks were able to do that. Even though they have citrate in their growth medium, there would be an advantage. It's just too big of a hill to climb, and the one flask just got incredibly lucky. So, like I said, I would not say that we have it all worked out. What I'm saying is we have a coherent theory where there's no gaps in our knowledge about that. But it's just one key part of it is the randomness of mutations and genetic alterations. And that you are not alone, by the way, in feeling quite uncomfortable with that as an explanation, but it's what we've got.
Well, yeah, no, and that makes sense. I mean, you know, the citrate, I think there are random mutations, but like, you know, for example, if you take a raindrop and you put it on a piece of glass, like it'll take one path and another raindrop will take a totally different path. You know, if you put the raindrop in that same path, you know, it'll follow the path of the previous one because it's got the water line. It's not a perfect example, but, you know, this idea of chaos theory that there are these small micro differences on the surface of the glass alter which way that the raindrop's going to fall. And I think I think you would agree that DNA is, there's a lot of moving parts when it comes to DNA and genes and you know, replication and all these things. So all I'm saying is that what we see is random, maybe random, and it may be not. And I'm guessing, I'm putting my money down, I'm going to Vegas, and I'm saying in 15 years, I think some of that random nature is going to be figured out. But I could be 100% wrong.
Well, listen, we've been wrong about some stuff before. That's for sure. There's a lot of stuff that we said could never be done and was done. But when it does come to when the discoveries do come, usually what we find is it's not that this whole line of thinking was wrong and we just have to throw it out. It's a tweak.
Mm-hmm, right.
So it's a nuance. It's adding nuance. And that's what's so frustrating sometimes in communicating science to non-scientists, is it seems like we're saying something different all the time. But what we're actually doing, it's like a spiral that's zeroing closer and closer into the truth, which is at the center.
Right.
And there's no other way to do that because science is incremental. And no generation has the final word. Everybody that comes after us will complete and correct what we're doing. And that's the beauty of it also. And it takes some pressure off too. Sometimes scientists get really worried about publishing things. They know they did everything right, but they're afraid to put it out there and be wrong because they know people will disagree. I'm always like, you're going to be wrong about stuff as a scientist. That's going to happen. But you can still contribute to the field by doing that because you put an idea out there, people test it. And, you know, that's how knowledge advances. You know, every failure is something learned.
Yeah, but no one wants to be the guy who came up with the boneheaded theory that everyone proved wrong, you know?
Yeah, it's true. Nobody remembers them. And I think that's a flaw in how we talk about science, frankly, because those bad ideas really led to good science, because the only way to really get rid of a bad idea is to test the hell out of it and to test it well.
So would you be for like the raspberry version of like the Nobel Prize? So like the scientist of the year came up with the dumbest theory, but it pushed forward another great theory?
Well, I would certainly like to see us acknowledge when that phenomenon happens. Yeah, I would be careful. I don't want to call it a Razzie because I think a Razzie is a genuine insult, right? But, you know, sort of like an honorable mention. You know, and in fact, actually, I'm working on a project now, and I can't say too much about it because it's very, very early on.
Sure.
But I was inspired by somebody who said something to me that I am absolutely sure is wrong, but it's interesting to me and it's curious. It's something about how the genome works and how the genome evolves over time. And part of this project that I was designed was I want to get the answer to that. And believe me, I would love it if I'm wrong and he's right, because I'd still get an answer. Like I'm not biased exactly. But he got me thinking, because I don't believe it can possibly work that way. So I want to prove him wrong.
Right.
And good friends can have passionate disagreements. In fact, I was actually at an event last weekend at the World Science Festival. And I was talking to David Sloan Wilson, and earlier in that day, I was talking to Michael Shermer, and they vigorously disagree on group selection and multi-level selection, but they like each other. They're friends, and they, you know, and 95% of their worldview is totally compatible. But on this one issue, everybody thinks of them as these, you know, rivals, when really what's just going on is this is how science works. Until you have a clear answer, you're going to have camps. And, you know, we're people just like anybody else, and we all want to be right. And so we do the best we can. And that's what's so great about science is it doesn't depend on any one personality. It's the whole community. It's self-correcting. We might get things wrong, but for a very, very short amount of time before the entire community, you know, comes in and corrects. And that's how we advance.
Well, that is a very human trait. I would argue a flaw that we have to still have a very tribal mentality. You know, it's still red team,
absolutely,
blue team. Which always strikes me as very odd. But I want to
let me just expand on that. I don't want to let it go, Dan, because I agree with you that tribalism and tribal mentality, we're so easy, so willing to pick up teams and then fight against those teams. And so it seems like such a negative. I don't know that we could have ever built society without that. So it might have negative consequences, but overall, it's really hard to see us get to where we are without that.
Sure. I mean, it's, but I mean, like, much like the other things in your book, it feels a little useless now, you know, like,
yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
It definitely not useless. That's a strong word, but definitely derisive in places where we don't need it. And it's kind of everywhere. There's no real one specific area where you could say like, oh, it's only here. It's like, it's in almost in every line of thought. You know, like here's an extremely fringe example, that, you know, and I'm going to use this because I think it represents kind of a generic example that people may or may not fall into, but I think fewer people are going to fall into this camp. But I went to, a Contact in the Desert, which is a UFO conference, here in Los Angeles. And so most people, when they think of people who are interested in UFOs, are like, oh, their UFOs were being visited by extraterrestrials, and there are people who don't believe in that, right? So two very simple camps. And it turns out that the people who believe in UFOs, none of them get along. And no one would know that unless you were in that camp. So even when you think people who, you know, I don't want to say ostracized by society, but are definitely a minority or have been for a long period of time, even those people fight amongst themselves on where UFOs come from, you know, who's, you know, is Bigfoot a part of that? Like, even the fringe people who should be all working together because there aren't as many of them, they're still infighting there. And like, that seems particularly harmful, you know, when people
I agree. It's the same
bizarre.
In the Bigfoot community.
Yeah.
It's the same in the Bigfoot community. You know, each one has a very different take on that classic video, the name I can't remember now. And
oh my God, I should know this off the top of my head.
You know the one.
Of course, one from the 70s. It's super famous.
Yeah. So, that's and I've had a taste of that myself. So when I first ended up in with my horns locked with the intelligent design community, I felt like I was just like in this weird street fight because they don't actually all agree with one another. They have very, very different positions, all in this big umbrella called intelligent design. So I was often arguing with people, but I was arguing with a position that they don't hold, actually. So they were like, I never said that. I don't believe that. And I'm like, wait a minute, but I read this. Like, well, that's not me. That's somebody else. So their whole community is actually quite divided on a lot of big issues. And so they don't have one coherent theory of intelligent design. And so that's why it was like I was, you know, punching a sheet. I couldn't get anywhere.
Right.
And I eventually just disengaged because if they want to be taken seriously, they have to come up with a scientific coherent, you know, a coherent scientific theory.
Right.
And they don't have that yet.
Right.
So I'm pretty much, you know, done with them. But for a long time, I was fighting with these intelligent designs, and I felt like I was just chasing my tail because none of it made any sense. What's funny though is they still have the tribal mentality though. They still have the glue that they're in the minority against the evolution believing scientific community, and so they lock arms with each other in public. So you'll never see them criticize each other. You'll never see them disagree with each other. I mean, very, very, very rarely. Even though they have fundamental disagreements about like the age of the earth and common descent. I mean, really big questions they disagree with. But the tribalism, you know, that trumps it all. So they will only have those discussions in private. In public, they're all on the same time that science is, you know, is wrong. And
But I mean, you know, this goes right into your book, because you have, like, as you mentioned, you have a whole section on these kind of cognitive flaws that we have, and that fits right into there, because it's this flaw in human thinking that obviously, as you mentioned, evolved for a reason because it was extraordinarily helpful. But there's a huge downside to it as well. You know, one of the other things I want to get to before we run out of time here, because I think it's an interesting segue, because it kind of articulates perfectly what we're talking about here, but in a biological level, and that is the development of sickle cell disease, which the whole chapter in this I thought was just amazing from an evolutionary standpoint, like what it is, how it developed, why it developed, and the fact that it has extraordinary advantages and disadvantages. It was like the perfect Hollywood story to me. It had everything: action, adventure, death, survival. So can we talk about this for a little bit?
Yeah, I'd be happy to. I mean, the sickle cell trait is a really interesting thing, as you said, genetically, because on the one hand, we all have two copies of every gene in our body, two versions, we'll say. Mm-hmm. They're not necessarily copies of each other, but two versions of every gene. One you got from your mom and one you got from your dad. Mm-hmm. Well, there's this one that what the gene is doesn't matter. We'll just call it the sickle cell gene. And if you have two normal copies, everything's fine. If you have two poor copies of this gene, two mutant copies of this gene, you will have sickle cell anemia. And in the modern world, if you're in a developed country, it will probably not kill you. You will have moments of crisis, particularly if you don't have good health insurance. But if you can live with it, you can reproduce with it. But that was not true for a very long time. Mm-hmm. It was a lethal condition to get two mutant versions of this gene. And so it became a genetic conundrum as we realized how old this gene is in our history. And we can do that by doing population genetics, because we see it in all kinds of populations around the world. How could something so harmful? I mean, remember, it's lethal. We're not talking about a bruised testicle here. We're talking about a lethal condition. Right. How could it not have been eliminated by evolution? Why would natural selection not just remove it from the population and quickly? Well, the answer is that, well, if you get two copies, you're done. But if you have only one copy of this gene, so either you got it from your mom or your dad, then you actually have this weird condition where you're resistant to malaria. So you won't get the sickle cell disease. You can sometimes have small symptoms, but not, you know, just in very specific cases. If your blood count drops and during strenuous exercise, but for the most part, you're fine. But you're resistant to malaria because the parasite, the plasmodium parasite, doesn't like those misshapen red blood cells. And so you're resistant to malaria. So that's why it's persisted in the population for so long, is that the heterozygotes, or the hybrids, if you want to call them that, had such an advantage because they don't get malaria and they don't get sickle cell anemia. But the ones but it will never completely take over the population, because if you have two normal genes and you don't get the malaria resistance. So there's no way to fully win. It's a tug of war where only the middle state is the advantageous one. And believe it or not, I was lecturing on this one time, and there was a creationist in the audience who said, well, this seems pretty simple to me then. You know, this malaria, this horrible curse of malaria, God's gift was the sickle cell gene. God's gift to these populations was the sickle cell gene. So I want you to think about all the things that have to be true for that statement to make sense.
First of all, that God
couldn't do anything better than to people with this lethal disease than giving them another lethal disease. So we'll kill a quarter of the population this way, a quarter of the population this way, and some of them will survive. Yeah. Just a ridiculous notion. But what's interesting is that in the population genetics today's populations, the only populations that really have a lot of the sickle cell gene are those who are descendant from populations where malaria was a constant problem. Mm. So sub-Saharan Africa, the Indian subcontinent, Southeast Asia, and a little bit in the Americas, but we believe the Americas actually is the African DNA in the Americas, right? Because there wasn't a lot. So that's just such a cool evolutionary story. It's tragic, but it also shows the limits of evolution. Evolution doesn't create perfection. Right. It's such a shame that natural selection couldn't have done better, but that's life.
Yeah, that was kind of, I mean, you know, it's because it's funny, like, how it must have been extraordinarily advantageous. It must have been, you know, however this mutation occurred, you know, it's just interesting that it was so effective, but also so deadly. Like, that is really the curse of the sickle cell gene. And it's just fascinating, these, to me, like these micro evolutions that have occurred, because, you know, human history has been around for so long. And, you know, as populations stay in certain parts of the world, as human beings have kind of explored and taken over the world and, you know, kind of walked into other, you know, other food chains and other, you know, biomes, it's just, it's interesting how the adaptations kind of exist amongst, you know, all of the different, you know, races and population of the world. It's just fascinating, these microevolutions that give you these distinct advantages in certain climates. I mean, it's just fascinating that, like, you know, evolution is still very modern, you know, I mean, from a historical sense.
We are still evolving. And one other thing to think about with sickle cell anemia specifically, but this will play out in other diseases as well, is it's not just the environment, it's also in how the genes are passed on. So we've also found that in the genes with the highest degree of this have a long history of polygyny, meaning a single male with a harem of wives. And when you have and what this means, and every, by the way, lots of men, when they think of that lifestyle, they think it's great. Let me tell you, that's the worst thing for males, is polygyny, because that means one male does well and 90% of the males don't get anything.
And they want to kill the male who's doing well. I mean,
it's actually a terrible life. Right. Monogamy came about by basically lesser males insisting on having equal access. It is not about the empowerment of women. It was
democracy.
The empowerment about lesser males.
Right, right.
But anyway, when you have what's called very uneven gene pool distribution, so one individual will leave a much bigger genetic legacy than the rest of them. And so that's how alleles can spread extremely fast, is one individual. And if the Genghis Khan was always the classic example, he left so many offspring all around Asia. So this one individual probably has now a billion descendants.
Wow.
And so when you have polygyny, meaning a man with lots of women, you have the ability to spread alleles very, very quickly. And so it seems to be that not only was there the environmental pressure, but there was also the social structures that allowed this to spread. And that's why you don't see it in some of the other parts of the world that do have mosquitoes and plasmodium.
Right.
They never got sickle cell anemia because the alleles just couldn't spread fast enough to do their thing.
And I mean, that's what's fascinating about, you know, any of these microevolutions, is that, you know, it's not just these random mutations, but it's also the social structure. Like, everything plays a part into how we've developed, which is, you know, and what people found, you know, attractive or you know, important for survival is also really interesting.
Sure. Yeah. And it changes over time. It's a moving target. Survival is a moving target.
Right. No, it totally is. Okay. So you're going to stick around. We didn't get into a lot of the design flaws. You're going to stick around for 10 minutes, right? We're going to talk about those.
Yeah.
Okay. So this is fascinating stuff. A great place to end it. So how can people find your book, find you on the internet? I assume you're way into social media.
The book is Human Errors. It's now out in paperback, so it's a little cheaper. It's on Audible. Find stores near you, and you can find me on Twitter, Nathan Lents, and I spend way too much time on Twitter, so I actually do usually answer most people who write me, unless you're mean. If you're mean, I don't answer you, but if you're a nice person with a good question, I'll be happy to answer.
Do you do Facebook, Instagram, any of that stuff?
Not Instagram. I do Facebook, yeah. I'm also there. It's Nathan.Lents.2.
The number two or T-W-O or yeah. T-O-O or T-O?
No, the number two, yeah. Okay. Apparently somebody beat me to it. Nathan.Lents.2.
Wow.
And also on Tumblr, Nathan Lents.
Okay. I'll have links to all that stuff. The book is just incredible. It's paradigm shifting. I don't say that very often. Human Errors, Dr. Nathan Lents. Thank you so much for being on the show today.
It is my pleasure. Happy to be here.
And I want to thank everyone for listening. Have a good night.
End of transmission. Thank you.